Okay, I think we can go ahead and get started. So hello everybody and thanks for joining us. Welcome to everyone joining from Babram Institute and to those joining from other organisations as well. It's a real pleasure to welcome our speaker today, Professor Mark Maslin, who's kindly offered to give us this special seminar for Earth Day. So Mark's a Professor of Earth System Science at UCL, Director of Rezatec Limited and Co-Director of the London NERC DTP. And his expertise includes causes of past and future global climate change, and he works on potential decarbonisation solutions and the politics of climate change. He's written some fantastic papers and books on the subject for anybody that's keen to learn more. And today he's going to give us a talk focused on climate change solutions. So thanks very much for agreeing to speak to us today, Mark, and I'll hand over to you.
Thank you, Jo, and thank you for inviting me. I think it's really important that we're doing these sort of events on Earth Day. It was 52 years ago that sort of Gaylord Nelson, a Democrat senator and governor, actually set up Earth Day because of the pollution that he saw around the United States, and it's grown and grown. What I want to do today is try to give you some insights into climate change, the challenge that we face, and also then the solutions, both at government, company, and individual level. And then I'm starting off with this cartoon because this cartoon is so seminal because it shows that we have suffered through COVID for the last 2 or 3 years. We've worried about its effects and flattening the curve. But we also realize that behind us in the future is actually a much bigger problem, which is climate change. So I understand that sort of like many of you are more in the biotech and the biological sort of like area. So I'm going to do a little bit of a recap on sort of the climate, the physics of climate change. So the interesting thing is that we've known about the greenhouse effect for about 150 years. It was Eunice Foote in the United States, a female scientist and activist. And what she did was do a very simple experiment. She took a test tube, put one of them in the actual sunlight with just normal air and a thermometer in, and one with CO2 with a thermometer in. And what she noticed is the one with the CO2 got hotter quicker, stayed warmer for longer than the one with air. And hence she basically described and wrote up the greenhouse effect. 5 years later, the great John Tyndall actually produced this equipment in the Royal Institution. You can still see it there today. And he was able with a thermocouple to actually measure that absorption of heat. And he showed that the most important greenhouse gas is water vapor, followed by things like CO2, methane and nitrous oxide. So what is the actual climate change? What is the greenhouse effect? So if you think about the sun's energy is mainly light, a little bit of UV, and it basically passes through the atmosphere as if it's not there. Luckily, a little bit of sort of ozone catches the UV radiation and stops it from causing skin cancer and DNA damage on life on Earth. But most of the energy basically literally hits the atmosphere. About a third of it is reflected back out into space from white clouds, ice sheets, and is lost directly. Two thirds of it hits the Earth's surface. Now, if you can imagine, you are not on your laptop, you're not in your office listening to the dulcet tones of Mark Maslin, but you're actually lying on a beach on a tropical island. You have your favorite cocktail there, just imagine that cocktail, and the sun is beating down on you. And what you feel is hot. And that's because the light energy hits your skin, converts to heat, and you have to radiate that heat away. Exactly the same happens with the Earth. It radiates that heat back out into space. But this is where the magic of the greenhouse gases comes in, because they capture some of that heat, they're agitated, they hold on for it for a little while, and then release it back into the atmosphere and out to space. This little holding of energy means that the temperature of the Earth is about 35 degrees warmer than if you strip them all out. So if you think about that, if we didn't have greenhouse gases, an English summer, being generous, would be about minus 15 degrees, and then English winter would be about minus 30 degrees. So greenhouse gases tick, good. But it was Guy Callender in 1938 that first noticed that the world was warming up. He basically took 147 weather stations from around the world, put all the temperature data together, and showed that there was a clear trend warming from the 1880s through to 1938. He had a few temperature measurements, a few CO2 measurements from around the world, and noticed that that was also going up. And he was the first person to actually link temperature change with CO2 rise. And he then postulated, because of all the burning of coal around the world, that this effect was going to increase. So we knew about climate change in 1938. So this is the Keeling curve, the famous Keeling curve. CO2 levels have risen by 50% since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, and it's at the highest level for the last 3 million years. As you can see, they have the annual variation going up and down, but the trend is always up. And the reason for that actual oscillation up and down, I'm a geographer, so therefore it's all to do with geography. There's more land in the Northern Hemisphere. So when spring happens in the Northern Hemisphere, all the plants suddenly explode into life. They suck CO2 out of the atmosphere and you get that dip. You get a much smaller dip when you're in the Southern Hemisphere because there's less land. And that's purely the breathing in and out of the planet. So let's have a look at the past. So this is the past 800,000 years, as we've seen in ice cores. And this is brilliant because we drill into Antarctica and Greenland. And what we do is extract these ice cores, and inside they have air bubbles. And those are literally ancient air trapped in ice. So if you can extract it perfectly, you then have a measure of how much CO2 and methane have been there in the past. And as you can see, we've increased methane by 150% since the beginning of the Holocene, and we've increased CO2 by 50%. So is there climate change? Can we see evidence of it? Well, if you like skiing or you like snowboarding because you've got stronger knees than me, then guess what? Northern Hemisphere spring snow cover has been dropping since the 1960s. Again, Arctic summer sea ice, we see this all the time. Roger Halliburton, before he retired from the BBC, went up every summer to show us that it was melting. And again, it's been melting back since about 1965. The one that worries me most is the average temperature or heat content of the upper ocean. The reason being is the oceans cover 70% of the world's surface and have a slow inertia, so they absorb heat. And look, it's been creeping up every single year. And sea level. We know that sea level has risen by about 24 centimeters in the last 100 years, and that is just slowly creeping up every single year. And of course, we always look at the annual global temperature. And again, the record is 2020 and 2016 were both the warmest year on record. You'll notice that I'm showing you at least three different data sets, one from NASA, one from NOAA, and one from the Met Office here at Exeter, because it's important that they collate the data around the world in slightly different ways. But as you can see, all of it shows that strong warming trend from sort of like the 1970s to the present day. Now, many of us basically look at wiggly lines and just go, okay, it sort of goes up. But Ed Hawkins, a dear friend and colleague at Reading University, has produced the climate stripes, or the warming stripes. Google it and you can then download actual stripes for any place in the world. So I've got the England temperatures, but you can get London, Cambridge, Oxford, New York, and therefore you can actually understand how temperatures have changed in your area. Now, of course, this has actually generated not just beautiful diagrams for PowerPoint, but ties, cars. Now, of course, I work on the principle, if you can afford a Tesla, you should definitely be able to afford to actually wrap it. I have to say, I would have actually done the temperatures the other way. I would have started with the blue at the bottom and gone to red at the top. But no, that's just me. But I can't afford a Tesla, so I'll never be able to do this. So I can afford the T-shirt. I could afford the leggings if I really wanted leggings. And of course, having been at COP26 and survived the pandemic, guess what? You can also get face masks. So what we really want to know as scientists is about the future. Now, many of you will have control experiments. You will have different experiments that you change just one variable, and therefore you can actually understand the system. Planetary scientists like myself, we would love to do the same. I'd like to have multiple Earths. I'd like to torture one, double the CO2, take another one, half it, and see what happens. Except we only have one beautiful blue planet. So what do? We build an artificial Earth. So we model it. So we use supercomputer models, and we actually produce the map as a grid, both into the land, around the land, and into the atmosphere. And the interesting thing is the science is really good. We understand thermodynamics. We understand fluid mechanics. We understand the chemistry. We've got that really well tied down. And also, I thought on the right-hand side, I'd show you how the change in resolution of the models. Okay, so in 1990, I can do a Brexit joke, Britain really was part of Europe because our resolution was about 500 kilometers per grid square. Now we're down to about 50 to 100 kilometers, and therefore we can resolve things like Iceland, Ireland, and lots of different small scale features. The really scary thing though is the actual science hasn't changed. Our models have got better. We've got more resolution. We've included more things. But guess what? The fundamental science is you put greenhouse gases into the atmosphere, the atmosphere warms up, the planet gets warmer, you get more extreme weather. So let's have a look at the future. So the problem with the models is not the science. It's you lot. And by you lot, I mean actually everybody in the world, because we're not sure how many people there will be by the end of the century. Actually, the UN estimates basically about plus or minus 1 billion. Oops, big error. We also don't know how much we're going to emit. Carbon, greenhouse gases, other greenhouse gases. So we talk about scenarios, or as I call them, stories. And these stories are put together by social science economists and scientists working together to understand how the economy of the world could change. The red line is the no climate policies. And this is something we were worried about, say, 10 years ago, when we were staring at a 4 to 5.5 degrees warming. The current policies, if they are all successful, mean that we're looking at, say, a 3.1 to 3.7. If the pledges and the promises made at Glasgow in COP26 last year are fulfilled, we're looking at, say, 2.4 to 2.8, which is great, but only if everything works out. And then there are the two aspirational targets. So the Paris Agreement said that we would hit 2 degrees, and therefore that's the upper one. And there's an aspirational target beyond that, which said, well, we really should keep the world to 1.5 degrees. We've already raised the temperature of the planet by 1.2 degrees. So there's not much space left for keeping it to 1.5 degrees. So what does the UK look like in the future? So summers are going to be even hotter and drier. We can see this is a medium sort of like scenario. We're looking at an increased average temperature of 2.8 to 3.2 in Southeast England, which means a big shift in temperature. And so it means that summers are going to be like those, if you're mature like myself, who can remember 1976, it'll be 1976, 2003, 2007, and the summer that was hotter than 76, 2018. That will be the new normal. You might want to say, well, why are you showing a picture of Dungeness? Well, I'm a geographer and we've all suffered with pub quizzes during lockdowns. And just wanted to say that the only technical desert in the whole of the United Kingdom is Dungeness. So you can surprise your friends with that geographical fact later this weekend. So 2003 was the worst heat wave to hit Europe, okay? And this is London. I use London as an example because it is a very good example of urban heat island. And as you can see, the temperatures, and these are nighttime temperatures, were incredibly hot in the center. It also shows that if you go west to Richmond upon Thames, nice and cool compared. I mean, there's something like a 5 to 6 degrees difference, and that's why lots of rich people live there. But this had a real huge effect. 70,000 excess deaths was recorded in Europe from this one heat wave. And heat waves are the silent killers because we don't recognize them. And as you can see, this is 2003. In July, we had the first peak in temperatures and peak in excess deaths. I think the great shame of the modern era is that I used to have to explain what excess deaths were. Now, with COVID, everybody knows. And you can see that in August, there was a much larger one. Now, these are mature people at nighttime, because elderly people during the day can rehydrate, move around, actually aerate themselves. But at night when they fall asleep, their body is unable to regulate the temperature and they pass away due to other complications. So therefore, on the death certificate, it doesn't say heat wave. It therefore causes an issue with understanding how many people are killed by heat waves. And the ridiculous thing is the temperatures peaked at 100 degrees Fahrenheit for the first time. Or as my friends in sort of Texas said, spring. Or my African friends went, nice, comfortable day, 34 degrees, absolutely. So you have to remember that it's not the temperature itself, but it's how society is set up to actually deal with it. Of course, if all of those elderly people had air conditioning in their old people's homes or at home, we wouldn't have lost any of them. And 2001, we have seen incredible extreme weather events. So this is Canada, where they got 49.5 degrees Celsius. I've worked in Africa, and I'm sure many of you have also worked in tropical countries. In the 40s, low 40s is incredibly difficult to work in. I cannot even imagine what 49.5 degrees would be like. And the risk of extreme seasons, this is, I'm using the summer of 2018 as an example in the UK. If we stick to the 1.5 degree pathway, then 1 in 4 summers will be as hot, 2 degree every other year, and anything above 3, it'll basically every summer will be as hot as 2018. And that's just the baseline. That doesn't take into account the extreme events that occur on top of that. Winters. Warm and wet, we are having more extreme rainfall events because as we are heating up the planet, more moisture is being pumped into the atmosphere, it's becoming moisture loaded and it being dumped, not just in large storms, but in microbursts. So this is England in 2020, Germany in 2021. But in 2021, we also saw microbursts in sort of like New York that flooded the subway, in southern London, which literally flooded sort of like roads and destroyed houses, and in China as well. We also then have to consider flood risk because of course, as sea level rises, it causes storm surges to be higher and more problematic. So again, this is the flood risk for the northern North Sea storms coming down and actually going up the Thames. Now, the interesting thing is the Environment Agency has plans to deal with sea level rise of up to 4 meters. But of course, it depends on which coastal city or town you live in, depends on what sort of protection you're going to get. So I love this picture. So this picture is from a docudrama which was about 10 years ago, called Flood. Yeah, it was on ITV. I mean, if you imagine what it would be like if it was on Channel 4, it would have been sex, death, and water. You know, it would have been a little bit more exciting. I also like this because there's a bit of a socialist heart in here that I love the fact that sort of like the House of Commons and the House of Lords are equally screwed. Now, just imagine the trillions of dollars of damage that would be done to not just the infrastructure of London and property, but also the ability for the 24-hour trading to continue around the world. Interruption of trade would happen, and this would be a nightmare. However, this is highly unlikely because we have plans to retrofit the Thames barrier, and basically we have protection all the way along the Thames. We also will still get these short, sharp, cold snaps like the beast from the east. And the reason being is, again, linked to climate change. Above Norway, all the sea ice has melted. And the problem here, that was acting as a wall to stop the Arctic and Siberian air whipping down across Scandinavia and hitting British land. And so what we have now is we have every so often 2 or 3 days of incredible cold, lots of snow, and then it melts within 2 days, which causes as much trouble as the actual snow. And what's interesting is people's perception. People go, oh, it was a cold winter last year. It's like, no, it wasn't. We had 2 days of snow, 2 days of melt, and basically the rest of the winter was warm and wet. So again, extreme variations of climate are occurring. For example, many of you may remember a couple of years ago, the cold snap in Texas, because of course, the actual sort of bend of the actual climate was so low that it actually hit Texas and snowed in Texas. So we're gonna need to adapt and rebuild things like the Thames barrier, things like the Dawlish railway line because of sea level rise and storm surges. So if we summarize the overall effects of climate change, we're gonna have more extreme storms, floods, droughts, heat waves, and wildfires. And we're also gonna have them in places that we have never had them before. And therefore people aren't prepared and don't have the protection they need. This may lead to food and water insecurity. However, I would argue that actually most of that is financial. At the moment, we produce enough food for 11 billion people. We only have 7.9 billion people on the planet, but 825 million people still go to bed feeling hungry every night because they don't have the money to buy the food. And then there's the may lead to migration and conflict. A lot of people have a simplistic link, climate change will cause conflict and migration. But we know there are incredibly complicated reasons for migration and for conflict. If we look at the Ukraine war, that has nothing to do with climate change. It has to do with politics and geopolitics and personalities. So again, we have to be very careful about linking those two. What we do know is that climate change is a threat multiplier. It will cause stresses on particular regions and particular countries, which could make water and food insecurity more likely and could also lead to increased migration and possible conflict. So what are we going to do about this? So the UN Paris Agreement, which was an incredible agreement in 2015, and I feel bad as a Brit turning around going, oh my word, the French were magnificent. The way they basically managed the diplomacy and got this agreement was quite incredible. And what it says is that we're going to cut global CO2 emissions to net zero during the 21st century. And I love the fact that they are very open about saying to achieve this require complete transformation of energy generation, industry, infrastructure, and personal behaviors. So basically everything has to change. So the challenge. So the pathways to 1.5 degrees are still technically feasible. Even the last IPCC report on mitigation that came out literally a week and a half ago says it's possible, but we have to drop emissions now. And to do this, to stick to 1.5 degrees, if we look at the red line, that's how it's been increasing. we need to get to net zero, so that's no emissions on average by 2050. And then after that, we do need to suck CO2 out of the atmosphere to make sure that we are in balance. And the last bit, we don't, most scientists don't tell politicians or anybody about that because, look, we think it's going to be hard enough to get to net zero. So let's not scare anybody by going, well, then we need to remove and have negative emissions. So did COVID help us? Because, okay, most of us, we stopped flying. We stopped using our cars. We stopped doing all of that stuff. Well, globally, emissions were still 93% of the 2019. And if we have a look at that, that literally meant that it was the same as 2006. The reason being is most of the emissions comes from energy generation. So 80% of energy generation around the world is still produced by fossil fuels. And we also then have, on top of that, agriculture, which produces quite a large emissions, and we still needed to eat. And all of those goods and services and all of those Amazon parcels that we were desperate to get while we were locked in, all fossil fuel driven. So what we need is we need win-win solutions. We need to actually rethink the way we deal with supply chains. We need to deal with our personal lives. And what I'm going to do in this part is hopefully lift you up a bit and give you some real positives, because the world is a-changing, as a certain singer said. So the first thing is that this solution is a tripartite: government, corporation, and individuals. So the first thing is government needs to step up. We need leadership. We need subsidies. We need taxation. We need regulation. We need enforcement. And it doesn't matter the mixture of those, because different countries will prioritize and have different politics, but we have all these tools of government to allow change to happen. And we need corporations to actually take that and step up, because they are the ones that can change quickly, they're dynamic, they're able to innovate very quickly, and we need them to actually change. And then individuals. We need individuals to basically put their dollar where their mouth is and buy stuff from corporations that are sustainable. We need them to lobby governments and to change their policies. And the other thing about individuals is they're really important within organizations, because it's individuals that change culture within government, within corporations, within universities, to make sure that they are on the same carbon neutral pathway as everybody else. I also like to stop here and talk about cost, because there's lots of right-wing politicians now that are whispering, going, oh, it's going to cost us too much to go net zero. We can't do it. So let's have a look at the hard-nosed economics. If we do not deal with climate change, it will cost us 20% of world GDP in 2050. Now, I can't do the compound interest, but 20% of how large the world economy will be in 30 years' time will be a huge amount of money, okay? That's the first thing. If we just change now, the infrastructure costs will just cost us 1% of world GDP, okay? Now, the really interesting thing is that the Downdraw project says if we do this right, if we decarbonize properly, and we do it with win-win-win solutions, then we could save the world $46 trillion, because as you improve people's health, you save money from health services. When you actually employ people, you make sure that you boost your economy. So there's lots of win-wins out there. So let's have a look. Boys, if you're listening, this is what you need to do. Actually, just have a plan would be helpful, okay? So possible government actions to achieve net zero: support renewable energy. Now, the really interesting thing is, for the last 20 years, I and many colleagues have been shouting at government around the world about energy security. Suddenly, with the Ukraine invasion, they've all suddenly turned around, we need energy security. It's like, really? We told you this. So it's interesting that the EU is already pledging that they are going to triple the amount of renewable energy that they are going to actually put in place in the next 10 years. Incredible, okay? Tax fossil fuels and cut fossil fuel subsidies. Fossil fuel subsidies, taxpayers around the world spend something like $500 billion on paying fossil fuel companies to dig up coal and oil and gas when we don't want them to. So we're actually subsidizing them to pollute the planet. Madness. Just think what you could do with $500 billion in, say, health services. Need to support electric cars, electric public transport. We need carbon neutral buildings, retrofitting. We need to reforest and rewild. Interestingly, of course, the world is becoming more urban. So even though the population of the world is increasing, we're living in more mega cities. So weirdly enough, the world is becoming a wilder place, and therefore there's so much more opportunity to rewild. Promote low emissions farming and diet, and support and expand emission trading schemes around the world. Last year, China put in a carbon trading scheme about the same size as the European one, and they are going to use the same ratchet mechanism to slowly make sure that the lid comes down and they start to drive reductions in emissions. And remember, the green economy is huge. Okay, so work that I did with a brilliant PhD student, Lucien Georgeson, showed that the global green economy was about $10 trillion. That's about an eighth of the global economy. And the reason we don't know about it is because it's in everything. It's not like oil, petrol, you know, it's because we don't see. It's the paper towels, it's the paper straws, it's the electric cars, it's the sustainable sort of like cleaning fluids. You know, it's because it's all part of our normal lives, we don't see it. In the UK, sales were about $328 billion, and in the green economy employs about 2 million people. So companies are key to this revolution. And I love the fact that sort of the Carbon Disclosure Project, CDP, has shown very clearly that corporations that actively manage and plan for climate change secure a 67% higher return than companies that don't. Microsoft is a really interesting sort of case. So 2 years ago, they announced that they're going carbon negative by 2030, which I have to say is great, but many companies, including my own university and Glasgow and Cambridge University, have all announced that we're going carbon neutral by 2030. But this is a sting in the tail. They turn around and say, well, between 2030 and 2050, we're going to remove all the carbon pollution from our company, from our supply chain, and from our value chain that's been emitted from since 1975 when the company was founded. That's huge. The reason being is supply chains are usually about 11 times bigger than the carbon emissions of the company itself. And this is why it's so important when you're looking at your carbon footprint to actually manage your supply chain as well. So what can companies do? Well, the first thing I always say is set transparent, meaningful greenhouse gas reduction targets. The reason being is people don't expect you to go carbon neutral overnight. And if you did, they won't believe you, okay? Because they know how difficult it is. So you need to measure everything, scope 1, 2, and 3. You need to actually then plan how you reduce it. And then you have a pathway towards that carbon neutrality. Easy wins, switch to 100% renewable energy. Engage employees in company sustainability agenda. I have to say, probably really naughtily, I call these people green viruses because I have worked with so many companies, whether $1 billion or startup, and it's those interesting conversations around the water cooler where people start to say, well, how can we do something differently? Why can't we be a sustainable company? And that drives a whole culture change. Use carbon neutral buildings or retrofit your buildings. Offset emissions through reforestation and rewilding. Link your ambition to your supply and value chain, even though I don't know what a value chain is. Lobby government to support change. Okay, I had a brilliant conversation with Deborah Meaden, one of the Dragon Den's entrepreneurs. And what's interesting is that we all agree that government needs to set strict regulation, but they also need to enforce it. Because as she said, she's brilliant. She's going to make money. Doesn't matter how the rules are. Just don't fiddle with the rules every year. Just keep the rules nice and strict. Make sure they're enforced. And the enforcement's important because what companies don't like is someone making more money because they're cheating, because they're not following the rules. So we also need to empower entrepreneurs to drive the green innovation. What's really interesting is many CEOs I talk to aren't particularly into sustainability or saving the planet, but the reason why their companies are going green is because they can't get the staff. Those young people with the dynamicism, the new ideas that companies really want to grab, don't want to work for companies that don't have an ethical or moral backbone. It's really interesting. They still want to be successful. They still want to earn lots of money, but they want to do it with a company that they feel that they have a moral relationship with, which I think is really interesting because CEOs are just having to change their company just to try and still keep the talent. I always get asked this, what can we as individuals do? Because I think by empowering ourselves, and this is not the fossil fuel lobby basically going, oh, it's all people's choices. It's because people choose to drive petrol cars that we're polluting the planet. No, this is not that, okay? Because that's a false dichotomy. This is about us actually empowering ourselves, doing something and actually making a difference and actually showing both corporations and government that we are serious about this. First thing, talk about it. I do not understand why we are happy to talk about a prime minister having drinks parties during COVID and whether he's going to actually decorate his flat with John Lewis furniture or not, but we won't talk about the greatest threat facing humanity. So, talk about it, because the interesting thing is I've seen this happen. Lots of us suffer from climate anxiety. We worry about this all the time. And suddenly we go to work or we go to our organization or we go to our football team and we suddenly talk to other people and they go, oh no, I'm worried about this too. And suddenly, oh, everybody's actually worried about this. Well, why don't we do something about it? And that dynamicism I've seen have changed billion-dollar companies. Not overnight, but over 5 years, they've gone from zero to hero. Things you can do for yourself, switch to a more plant-based diet. Okay, this will make you healthier, live longer, happier, make your kids happier. Okay, now, this isn't give up meat forever. Yeah, you can still have that really nice steak once a month, maybe once every 2 months, you know, but it's about making a fundamental change to the majority of the food you eat. Switch to a renewable energy supplier. Hey, when we can afford to actually switch, reduce, reuse, recycle more, we know all of that. Reduce your consumption. One of the things that we all discovered during the pandemic is what makes us happy. It's our family, our friends, being able to hug them, being able to see them, being social, going out. Those are the things that make us human. And those are the things that we actually like to do. We're ultra social organisms. We love that sociality, okay? I'm really sorry. The number of t-shirts doesn't make you happy. The number of designer trainers or sunglasses you have does not make you happier, okay? I am not happier than my parents, and I have a lot more stuff than my parents ever have. So as you're reducing your consumption, because you don't need this stuff, you just need friends and family, you still consume, we all do, okay? Therefore, consume with trusted sustainable brands. Think about who you're actually going to put your money with, who are trustworthy, okay? Walk and cycle as much as possible. It'll keep you alive a lot longer, make you fitter, make you happier. And also use electric or hybrid cars if you have to, they are, and wrap your car if you can, fly less, and question when you fly, how you're going to actually deal with that, whether you offset or whether you actually do something else in another part of your life or your organization to deal with that. if you are lucky enough to have a pension or investments, divest them from fossil fuels, okay? Because in the short term, they are making more gains because of the energy crisis at this moment in time, but they are a bad long-term benefit for your pension or investments. So invest in the green economy. And also, if we take money away from them, then people are going to shift into renewables and other forms of energy to invest in. Vote and protest. I have to say, I was lucky enough to be at Glasgow. I saw what true protest was like. It was amazing. So the battle against climate change will be won and lost in this post-pandemic recovery. And I love this juxtaposition here. On the left-hand side is Paris with the Eiffel Tower in the background. And as you can see, we have the beautiful green sort of city, beautiful green towers, etc., a forest within the city. And then on the right-hand side, New York, as portrayed in the original Planet of the Apes film, and there's Charlton Heston basically pounding the sand, going, damn it all to hell, we burnt it, okay? So we have that choice. I also thought I'd do a quick summation of the Glasgow Climate Pact and what happened in Glasgow, just so people have a feel for that, because there's so much mixed messaging that came out of it. My take home was it was a small step forward with no backsliding, okay? So it was good, but it could have been much better. Strong statements of 1.5 degree target, perfect. We also had phase down of coal and removal of inefficient fossil fuel subsidies in the actual pact. Now, this sounds strange. This is the first time that fossil fuels have ever been mentioned in a climate change agreement. I know, weird. New NDCs or pledges are going to be made this year at COP27. And we think that we could be moving from a 5-year to a 1-year cycle, which will be able to actually generate much more incentive to countries to actually change quicker and quicker. Article 6, the carbon trading and accountancy for countries and companies, was finished. We're not quite sure. It's been agreed by everybody. We're not sure what it means, but again, it means that we can actually start trading carbon properly. It failed to honor the 2009 1 billion commitment. We did not create the Glasgow Loss and Damage Facility because that was blocked by the EU and the US. And we still, the NDCs do not match the Paris Agreement 1.5 degrees pathway. We're still looking at 2.4, 2.8 of warming at least, best case scenario, if all those policies are followed. So thank you for listening, and I'm happy to take questions. And I just wanted to finish with two things. The first one is this brilliant cartoon by Joe Pett. This was actually before the Copenhagen conference in 2009, which went, oh, so horribly wrong, mainly due to Obama. But think about it. We could have energy independence and security. We could save the rainforest. We could have sustainability. We could have green jobs. We could have livable cities, renewable energy, clean water, clean air, healthy children. And there is always somebody at the back who's saying, what if it's a big hoax and we've created a better world for nothing? All the facts that I've talked about in this talk are in my book, How to Save Our Planet, the facts, which is available at all good booksellers and is really quite short and snappy if you'd like to have further information. And I'll stop there, and I'm happy to answer any questions.